You know what? This saga was good. Like, this saga was really good. And I enjoyed reading it as I was reading it. But then after I get done reading these things, I have to go back and kind of collect my thoughts in order to, you know, make a video about it. And yeah, this was a good saga. And this is, in all honesty, this was a saga that could have gone off the rails at any minute. Now, this saga opens with Trunks, who's like a Super Saiyan from the future, who has, his future is, like, the world has ended, and Goku's dead, and everything's terrible, and he's gonna come back in time, and he's gonna attempt to save his future and our present, or something. And I love Trunks, and I absolutely will not apologize for it. I don't have any idea if you're, like, allowed to like Trunks nowadays or not, but back when I was a child, and this was on air in the 90s, you were not allowed to like Trunks. He was not cool. Like, if Vegeta was the ultimate cool character that everybody was obsessed with, Trunks was the antithesis of that. And you were not allowed to like him. He was the most uncool character ever. And you were shamed for liking Trunks, and I will not apologize for it. I liked him then, and I like him now. Actually, if you could do me a huge favor in the comments, tell me if it's actually okay to like Trunks in 2024, because boy, 1998? No, not cool, dude. Anyway, like I said, this whole saga felt like it could go literally off the rails at any minute, and somehow it didn't. And it, like, somehow was great at the same time. Like, it is my understanding that androids 19 and 20 were supposed to be, like, the main antagonist for the entire saga. Which the editor said, no, that's not cool, we're not doing that, that's unacceptable. So he created 17 and 18, and the editors then came back, slapped him down again, said, no, what are you doing? Give us a real bad guy, at which point he came back with Cell. And that is a lot of rewriting of a saga just because things aren't going well. Then add to that that the primary storyline of this is essentially piggybacking off of the Red Ribbon Army section of the original Dragon Ball run, which was my personal least favorite section out of the entire run of Dragon Ball. Not to mention the fact that the main story beats of this are going to be, there's a new big bad in town, then we're going to have to level up in order to fight him, essentially gaining a new level of Super Saiyan, kind of like the same thing we did last time around. In other words, the big brain idea for this is to just repeat all the same story beats from the last time around. And I'm still just listing the ways that this could have failed. And it absolutely, somehow, did not do that. So let's talk about that. And to be quite honest, I personally didn't have any problem with the androids. I thought they were just fine. I don't know what the big beef with them was. 18 and 19 or 19 and 20 or 17 and 18. I thought they were all pretty well okay. Although the older people were cooler than the younger ones in my personal opinion. Like, as far as main bad guys are concerned, the little kids were a little weird. But either way, I didn't have a problem with any of them. Now, could they have been the big bads for an entire saga, and could they have carried an entire saga by themselves? That I'm not entirely sure. But I didn't think that they were terrible characters, or at least not as bad as I feel like the stories make it sound like the editors thought they were. Also, by downgrading them and adding in Cell, it gave them an opportunity from a writing standpoint to add in some parallels to the previous Dragon Ball manga and really tie in some story beats thematically with things that have happened in the past and do it all kind of simultaneously within this one saga. And they just hit so well and it worked. So well. It almost felt like it was planned, even though it wasn't. And to be quite honest, this saga really benefits from that repetitive storytelling. I think I called it circular storytelling in one of my previous videos, where it feels like we're kind of telling the same story over and over again in slightly different ways. Well, we're going to do that a couple of times simultaneously in this one, and it really, really pays off big time. But anyway, after we get the introduction of our two main failed protagonists, or two groups of main failed protagonists, we get the introduction of Cell. And that introduction really felt like it was channeling some, like, real horror movie vibes with the way that him and his egg and everything is introduced. Now, granted, it doesn't have quite the same tone as a horror movie would. It still feels very Dragon Ball, but it really felt like Dragon Ball was channeling its inner horror movie. The DNA was there, is what I'm saying, and I thoroughly enjoyed it and appreciated it. We also relatively early on get that big payoff of Piccolo merging with Kami, which was hinted at a long time ago, like way before, was it either early in the Frieza Saga or even before the Frieza Saga, when way before he merged with that one dude on Namek. But anyway, yeah, that was hinted at forever ago. We finally get that payoff. And actually, in terms of big, special, heavy-hitting moments, maybe strong emotional beat moments, this saga had quite a few of them, and they land very, very well. Anyway, real quick, cycling back to the juggling of all these main bad guys that we kind of add in this saga with all the androids and Cell, and now we've got all these people, and it actually afforded them the opportunity to call back multiple storylines from multiple bad guys all at the same time. We end up getting Cell, this big bad, ultimate big bad, who's just gonna have to be put down in the vein of Frieza. Then at the same time, we get all of the androids who then kind of, because they got downgraded, get to be incorporated into the group in a sense, maybe in a way, at least one of them will be ultimately. But they kind of end up fighting alongside the good guys, like some of our other previous big bads have. Think the Demon King Piccolo or Vegeta. So we can simultaneously, because we accidentally injected too many bad guys into this saga, we get to then like pay off multiple threads from multiple sagas in the past in the same saga now simultaneously. And it is wonderful. It works so well. That's the part where I'm like, you almost would have thought that they planned it from the get-go, even though it was just kind of like, how the fuck do we handle this situation? We've written ourselves into a weird corner here. How do we get out of it? And it just could not have went better. And then, of course, that is going to be punctuated by another transformation into another version of Super Saiyan and yet another tournament, making this essentially an entire saga of mostly callbacks, and somehow it still feels original, unique, and a product in and of itself that is wonderful. Also, they bring back that room of whatever where they can go and train for a day, and it's actually a year, and then they can all cycle in and out of training to prep for this Cell saga, which is just always so satisfying to get these training sequences and montages in Dragon Ball. I don't know if it's quite as awesome as that training sequence with Goku in the ship. That might still be my favorite training sequence ever, but these are still good, and I just love them. I don't know why. It's just like, it's kind of like the equivalent of comfort food when it comes to the Dragon Ball manga. There's something satisfying about the training sequences. I don't know. Maybe it's just me. And also, can we all just appreciate the scene when Gohan comes out and he's all leveled up and everything and they're getting ready for the fight and he specifically requests a uniform that looks like Piccolo's? That was one of those great moments for me that I kind of keep talking about. So, okay, let's talk about some of those special moments that really hit hard for me anyway, because basically this is going to play out. Cell's going to evolve into Perfect Cell, and they're going to all have to take him out. The end, you know? Although, along the lines there, Cell transforming into Perfect Cell. Perfect Cell looks pretty cool. Although, that one in-between transformation before he gets to Perfect Cell? Fucking terrible. But anyway, we get him taking down Trunks at one point, and Vegeta loses his shit. Which was such a good moment, because Vegeta's been pretending to be this specific kind of person this whole time. I don't give a shit about you. I don't give a shit about anyone. Fuck Trunks and all of this stuff. And he acts like he hates him in the training room. He acts like he wants to be on the other side of the world, anywhere that's not next to Trunks. But when it comes down to it and something happens to him and he gets hurt, Vegeta loses his mind, which is like just a real nice human moment, for the first real good human moment, if I'm not mistaken, that we get with Vegeta. And that's that first crack in his facade and his, you know, persona that he puts on. And it was just a really, really good moment. I loved that one. Also, I just love Goku in this saga. He's just, first off, I love Goku, period. He's been just one of the greatest characters, like main characters for a manga, just to read that fun, just that energy that he brings to everything is so great. And then that energy in this one, that fun, loving, happy-go-lucky, never can bring him down attitude. And that has now shifted into it the same thing, but now it's also got this underlying current of he knows that he's not going to be the one to do this one. He knows he's not going to win this one because in the training room, his son has surpassed him. And he knows now that if anyone's going to be the one to do this, it's going to have to be Gohan. And he knows this from the entire outset of it, and he still carries that same attitude, and it just bolsters that almost like a fatherly pride mixed into his normal happy-go-lucky attitude. I just enjoy him in general, and then in this saga, the way it all came together was just great. Then on top of that, maybe the greatest moment in the entire thing, and we all know that death isn't permanent in Dragon Ball. Nothing about death ever really lasts. They always find some way, shape, or form to get out of it. But that does not diminish the scene of Goku sacrificing himself in order to save everybody else when Cell is getting ready to explode was just one of the greatest moments, maybe the greatest moment so far in all of Dragon Ball. Just some of the panels of him saying goodbye to the crew were phenomenal. Oh my God. And then it doesn't even work because Cell comes back and it doesn't feel cheapened or lessened or diminished at all when Cell comes back and you realize, well, he kind of did that for nothing. It still feels just as good then as it did before, because now you actually get the actual conclusion of Gohan having to actually do this by himself. And now without Goku even being there, Gohan has to still do this by himself and come out on top. And that feels just as good as Goku sacrificing himself. And like I said, the Goku sacrifice thing doesn't feel cheapened by it. It was so good. I really enjoyed the end of this. And then, after all of that happens, then we get the actual conclusion to Trunks' story. And he goes back to his timeline in his future, where he then cleans up his timeline and he does all of that. And we get that, and that ending is so super satisfying. And just to touch on that whole time travel thing here for just a second, because I mentioned in the beginning that time travel was kind of part of the messy part of this, because time travel in stories is so easy to fuck up. There are so many different ways of doing it, and so many times it just muddies up the story, and it really just, it's so easy to just mess the whole thing up by adding time travel into something, and then you end up with all this. Yeah, it gets ugly fast. And I feel like this genuinely sidestepped all of the real major drawbacks to it. You kind of get some fun with the time travel. You get Trunks, but it doesn't really mess up our timeline, and it kind of causes his own timeline. And they keep it just vague enough that they don't get overly bogged down with it, and they don't really mess up the story with it. They kind of bring it in, they play with it a bit, and they get rid of it. And I think it was handled quite well as far as time travel stories is concerned. And then at the end of all of it, I personally was a little sad to see Trunks go, because I don't know why I like Trunks so much. I just enjoyed his character. And then he jumps in and he dips out, and I'm like, Aw, he's sad. And I know that in the future we will get another version of Trunks. And he's not gone from the story. But this version is. He's pretty much, as far as I'm aware, gone. And that makes me sad because this is the version that I was kind of attached to. Anyway, I liked it. I thought it was a good read. And now we get down to the end here where I'm going to attempt to rank this. And I kind of stuck myself into a corner here because I'm going to give this the exact same score that I gave the Frieza Saga. Because to be quite honest, as I was thinking about this, I don't know which one I like better. The Frieza Saga is so good. And this Cell Saga was so good. The Frieza Saga was maybe a little bit more original. Is that what I want to say? With the way it went off planet and played out. And this one was a little bit more of a saga of callbacks. But they were so, so well done. I'm not 100% sure. I know that ultimately I'm going to have to make a, like, sagas ranked video. And I will eventually have to put my money on which one is better. Because, you know, that's just what I do here. And I stubbornly like to make those videos. So eventually I'm going to have to decide. But as of right now, I really put a gun to my head. I don't know which one I liked better. So I'm going to just rank them equally. So it's going to have to get whatever I gave the last one. I think it was an 8.5. And that feels low. I even said in that video, I think it felt low for that saga. So they'll probably both end up being more like 9s. But that's not the point. The point is that right now I'm just going to call them the exact same because I can't decide. That's how good this was, or at least that's how good they both are. Anyway, everybody, as always, the link for my Patreon's in the description below. The link for my Discord's in the description below. Thank you for watching, and I'll see you next time.